Hello students, today's topics are Napoleonic Code, the making of nationalism in Europe, the aristocracy and the new middle class, and liberal nationalism. See, Napoleonic Code, that is the reforms introduced by Napoleon to create uniform identity in France. Let us see what are they. Napoleon had no doubt destroyed democracy in France, but in administrative field he had incorporated, means introduced, revolutionary principles in order to make the whole system more rational and efficient. Second thing is that he abolished all privileges based on birth. It also established equality before the law and secured the right to property. These reforms introduced by Napoleon is also called the Civil Code of 1804. This code was exported to the regions under French control. Those regions were under France. These reforms exported to there also. Napoleon simplified administrative divisions, abolished the feudal system, freed peasants from serfdom and manorial dues. Under feudalism, there was serfdom and manorial dues. Peasants paid all these taxes to the lords. In the towns, guild restrictions were removed. What is guild restrictions? Trade restrictions. It was removed. Transport and communication systems were improved. Peasants, artisans, workers, and new businessmen enjoyed a newfound freedom under Napoleon. Businessmen and small-scale producers of goods began to realize that uniform laws, standardized weights and measures, and a common national currency, all these facilitated their movement. They began to enjoy a newfound freedom. In spite of all these, the reactions of the local populations to French rule were mixed. Though there were so many relaxations and reforms introduced by Napoleon, but the reactions of the people were different. Initially, at the beginning, in many places, such as Holland and Switzerland, Brussels, Warsaw, the French armies were welcomed. But later, the enthusiasm soon turned into hostility. It became unfriendly. The new administrative arrangements did not go hand in hand with the political freedom. Increased taxation, censorship, forced recruitment into the French armies, required to conquer the rest of Europe. All these policies outweighed the advantages of the administrative changes. Because of these practices, such as increased taxation, censorship, forced recruitment to armies. These things outweighed the advantages. So, Napoleonic administrative reforms did not get that much popularity out of France. Now, our next topic is that the making of nationalism in Europe. You know that, like Germany, Italy, Switzerland were also divided into kingdoms. Eastern and Central Europe were under autocratic monarchies, dictatorship, within the territories of which lived diverse people. There was no unity among the people of the country. They did not see themselves as sharing a collective identity or common culture. Among these people, there was no common culture. There was no collective identity. The Habsburg Empire, very big empire in Europe, that ruled over Austria-Hungary. It was a patchwork of many different regions and people. The aristocracy was predominantly German-speaking. The ruling class was mainly German-speaking. The Italian-speaking provinces were also there. In Hungary, half of the population spoke Magyar, a regional language. In Galicia, the aristocracy spoke Polish. Such differences did not easily promote a sense of political unity. Due to these differences, there was very difficult to establish a sense of political unity. The only tie binding these diverse groups, the only thing which connected these people, was a common allegiance to the emperor. Their emperor was same. There was only one emperor for these diverse groups. Among the people, there was no unity. There was no political unity. Next thing is that the aristocracy and the middle class. A landed aristocracy was the dominant class on the continent. In Europe, there was a landed aristocracy. It was the dominant class. They owned estates in the countryside, that is in village areas, and also townhouses. They had property in towns as well as in villages. They spoke French for purposes of diplomacy. For administrative purposes, they spoke which language? French. And in high society, they spoke French. Their families were often connected by ties of marriage. There was marriage relationship between their families. The majority of the population was made up of the peasantry, farmers. Majority people were farmers. In Western and parts of Central Europe, the growth of industrial production and trade led to the growth of towns and the emergence of commercial classes because of industrial production. You know, towns were increased and also a new class of people that is business class emerged. Industrialization began in England in the second half of the 18th century. It was started in England, due to which new social groups came into being. What was that? A working class population. Due to industrialization, a new social group was emerged, that is a working class population, workers. And the middle classes made up of industrialists, businessmen and professionals. It was among the educated, liberal middle classes that ideas of national unity following the abolition of aristocratic privileges gained popularity. It means because of the emergence of educated, liberal-minded middle class people, an idea of national unity got popularity. Our next topic is that liberal nationalism. What is liberal nationalism? Yes, before going into liberal nationalism, just have a look on the impact of the Industrial Revolution. Already we discussed here. Again, see the points. Growth of cities and towns. Emergence of commercial classes. Rise of middle class consisting of industrialists, businessmen and professionals. There were educated, liberal-minded people. They wanted the removal of aristocratic privileges. So all these points were showing the impact of industrialization. Now, liberal nationalism. What is liberalism or liberal nationalism? There are social liberalism, political liberalism, and economic liberalism. Three liberal nationalisms are there. First of all, we see what is liberalism. The term liberalism derives from the Latin word liber, meaning free. That is freedom. For the new middle classes, liberalism stood for freedom for the individual and equality of all before the law. For the new middle classes, liberalism means equality and freedom for the individual. Politically, it emphasized the concept of government by consent. Means government should be formed by the consent of the people. That is liberalism in politics or political liberalism. Yes, you may remember in revolutionary France that the right to vote was not granted to all. It has been given to propertied men. Only men without property and all women were excluded from political rights in France. Yes, we are familiar with this. In French Revolution, we discussed in detail about the voting rights of French people. There were active citizens as well as passive citizens. Women did not get any right to vote. However, the Napoleonic Code went back to limited suffrage and reduced women to the status of a minor. Throughout the 19th and early 20th centuries, women and non-propertied men organized opposition movements for equal political rights. You know, in France, there were so many movements and organizations were formed for agitating against the existing suffrage system. They wanted to establish universal suffrage, voting right for non-propertied men as well as for women. Next topic is that liberalism in economics. What is the importance of economic liberalism? In economic sphere, liberalism stood for the freedom of markets and the abolition of state-imposed restrictions. On the movement of goods and the capital, means traders are free to move their goods and services from one market to other. During the 19th century, this was a strong demand of the emerging middle classes. During 19th century, the emerging middle classes demanded freedom of markets, free movement of goods and services. Napoleon's administrative measures had created out of countless small principalities a confederation of 39 states. You know, German state, Germany, it was a confederation of 39 states. Each of these possessed its own currency. There was no uniform currency, and weights and measures were also different at different states. Duties were often levied according to the weight or measurement of the goods. There were no uniform weights and measures, and duties were also different according to different weighing and measurement system. As each region had its own system of weights and measures, this involved time-consuming calculation, because at different places, different weights and measures, that they consumed more time also, created more inconveniences for traders also. For example, the measure of cloth was the ellie, which each region stood for a different length. An ellie of textile material bought in Frankfurt would get you 54.7 centimeter of cloth. In Mainz, it was 55.1 centimeter. In Nuremberg, 65.6 centimeter. See, same bundle of cloth measured different measurement system at different places. See the difference. How much inconveniences caused for the traders. Such conditions were viewed as obstacles, hindrances to economic exchange and growth by the new commercial classes. So the new commercial classes argued for creation of a unified economic territory. They wanted to have a unified economic territory, an open market. In 1834, a customs union or Zollverein, a customs union was established in 1834. was formed at the initiative of Prussia and joined by most of the German states. Because of the initiative of Prussia, a new customs union was established, formed. The union abolished tariff barriers and reduced the number of currencies from 30 to 2. There were many currencies were introduced. It was existed, and these currencies were transacted at different places. In order to reduce the inconveniences of the traders, the number of currencies were reduced to 2. The creation of a network of railways further stimulated mobility of goods and people. As a result, a wave of economic nationalism strengthened the wider nationalist sentiments growing at the time. Because of all these reforms, a new nationalist sentiments developed in Europe at that time.